Again, we're very fortunate to have captured Professor Margetts. She arrived last night and she's leaving this evening. And she's here specifically for this course. So I can't tell you how lucky you guys are, because it's not every day that we manage to capture so many distinguished professors in one program. So I consider it a great feat on our part, and also a great good luck. Professor Margetts is a director and professor of society and the internet of the Oxford Internet Institute. And she is a political scientist specializing in digital area governance and politics, political behavior, digital government, and government-citizen interactions in the age of internet, social media, and big data. She's a fellow of the Academy of Social Sciences, and she has won a number of awards and also sits on the Digital Advisory Board of the UK Government Digital Service and the World Economic Forum Global Agenda Council on the Future of Government. Ladies and gentlemen, let us welcome Professor Margetts.
Thank you very much. Well, it's a great pleasure to be here, and I feel lucky too, because I was never in Hong Kong before. So I hope to tell you something, but I also hope to learn something too. And like Professor Hopper, I'd like to say, well, if I say something that doesn't seem right in the Hong Kong context, please forgive me. I'm here to learn too, and I hope together we can make it relevant. So I am a professor at the University of Oxford, also the director of the Oxford Internet Institute. As Angelina said, I specialize in the relationship between digital technology and government. I've been doing that for a long time. In fact, I've been doing that since the days when it was a very sad and lonely thing to do, to think about government and digital technology. Because until the internet came along, until the internet and social media came along, really, digital technology didn't make very much difference to the relationship between government and society. It was an internal thing, the closed, hidden world of government information systems that I wrote my PhD thesis about back in the 1990s. It was only when the internet came along that it really kind of made a difference to citizens as well. The internet was the first digital technology, really, that citizens domesticated as well as government, and that makes it a much more exciting topic. I'm sure in the 1990s, probably it's very unlikely that you would have flown me over from Oxford to talk about it to you. So from the 1990s, when really I was looking at the systems internal to government through several big policy reports for the UK National Audit Office, where we analysed in depth the relationship between UK government and the internet and the web, to the book Digital Era Governance, which is mentioned in the presentation that you have copies in, to the book that I've just completed and is coming out this year, looking at citizens and mobilisation and social media, called Political Turbulence, the clues in the title, to the argument, so that it maybe comes into the category of one of those books you don't actually have to read once you know the title. I have been specialising on this area. Patrick Dunleavy from the London School of Economics and I are now writing a new book called Essentially Digital Governance, which will come out next year with Oxford University Press, and hence the reason for the title of this talk. And I hope to talk about some of the ideas from that new book and discuss them with you. Before I start doing that, I'd just like to have a word to mention something about the Oxford Internet Institute, the department which I direct, and I'll come back to that later on, because some of these issues, I believe, are relevant to government more generally. That is, we're a department of the University of Oxford. We're one of the newer departments. We're only 12 years old, which is very, very new in Oxford terms, and Cambridge terms too, I'm sure. And we're unusual because we're multidisciplinary. That is, I'm a political scientist, as I've just said, but my colleagues here are sociologists, economists, anthropologists. We have a historian. We have a psychologist. We have a team of geographers looking at the geography of the internet, all the disciplines within the social sciences, but also outside the social sciences. We have a professor of philosophy, Luciano Floridi, here, who specializes in the ethics of information, is the kind of founding father of the field of the ethics of information. And I'll come back to that because it's very relevant to any discussion we might have about big data. We also have here, we were created to investigate the relationship between society and the internet, between society and digital technologies, not the technology of the internet, as would be in Professor Hopper's department. So we were deliberately made a department in the social sciences. But these days, you can't understand digital life. You can't understand life at all unless you can understand some of the technology. And for that reason, we have also in the department, among these people, several photographed here, several computer scientists, and also Taha Yasseri, the physicist, works closely with me as a political scientist. If someone had told me 20 years ago that I was going to be working with a physicist and that he would be a co-author on my latest book, I would have been very surprised indeed. But I can't do the kind of research I do now without that kind of expertise, and I'll come back to that later. So that's what I'm going to talk about, a little bit about how the world is changing, how society is changing with digital technology, because although 20 years ago when I wrote my thesis, I don't think that would have been relevant to the topic of digital government, now it's so relevant, I don't think we can think about digital government without thinking about how society is changing. I'm going to say something about how we can use big data or large-scale data, the kind of data that's generated from digital society, to understand institutions and how we do government. I'll say something about current trends in governance in the digital era, and then go on to talk about the future and how to give you some principles for how we might design digital government in the future. In this way, I think this talk will pick up on several of the trends that Professor Hopper has mentioned in terms of how the kind of technological trends that might be put to societal use can actually be used in the process of doing government, in the process of governing. So, as I said, the internet, social media, and associated digital technologies are really now intertwined with people's lives in a way that we haven't really seen before. It's having all sorts of unexpected consequences for the way we deal our lives, injecting a process of change into daily life at a speed which we certainly haven't seen before. Just a few statistics. We're very used to the idea that the penetration of the internet, that the percentage of populations using the internet is growing. But what we must remember is it's growing right across the world, everywhere now. For example, here we see in sub-Saharan Africa, internet penetration hitting 20% and rising all the time with the growth of the mobile internet. I think we've really reached a point now in the UK and North America where, although we still have to think about the people who don't have internet access, increasingly even those people who don't have access have access, for example, to some kind of member of their family or a friend who can use the internet on their behalf. Survey of research suggests that if you include those people as internet users, you're really only left with about 10% of the population in the UK who actually have no connection to the internet. And with the mobile internet and with smartphones, we're seeing, especially among younger cohorts, we're seeing people who think they don't use the internet but still access social media on their mobile phones. They just don't see it as the internet. And that's an important phenomenon because all sorts of things are arising from that. And we tend to forget about those people when we talk about what you can do on the internet. And coming to social media, of course, the inexorable rise of social media platforms. This one is Facebook. And we're all used to the idea of the huge numbers of people who use Facebook. But an ever-increasing variety of social media platforms and an ever-increasing churn between social media platforms in terms of how many people use them, especially, again, among younger cohorts. What's the relevance of that for government? Well, I think one of the key points of relevance for government about social media is the way that it gives people the opportunity to engage with policy issues, with political issues, with issues of government in a new way. What's new about it? Well, I think what's new about it is the facility to make kind of micro donations to the public good or public policy or to social and political causes. What you might call tiny acts of political participation, liking something, following some cause or campaign, signing a petition, tweeting something, retweeting something, downloading an issue, watching a video related to a political cause. All these things are very, very small acts of political participation, which before the transaction costs of doing them would just be so high. People can give very small amounts of money to political causes in ways that just wouldn't have been possible before, because by the time you'd found the cause and written the check and sent it off in the post, the costs in doing that would have outweighed, say, a very small donation of $1 or $2. Sorry, that's not Hong Kong dollars, actually, come to think of it. But I mean, we are very used to the idea now that you can make micro donations. Obama's 2008 presidential campaign made the idea of micro donation of money. It was that raised more money in micro donations than any campaign ever before. But I'm not just talking about money here. I'm talking about very small contributions of time and effort. That's the UK petitions platform where people can petition the government. That's another example of these tiny acts of participation. As soon as somebody's made a tiny act of participation, they can share it across multiple platforms. So if you sign a petition, here's some three tweets relating to somebody having signed a petition and then passed it on to their followers and on to other people. Now, those tiny acts of participation can scale up to really large-scale mobilizations. Now, of course, this is Tahrir Square in Egypt in 2011. Those people aren't making a tiny act of participation. They're making a really large one because they're standing in that square and exposing themselves to great danger and risk. But to get to that point, there are all kinds of, particularly on Facebook in this context, but it varies from country to country, social media platforms can play a really important part in getting people to that point. For example, the Facebook page, We Are All Khalid Said in Egypt, showing a young man brutally beaten up by police, had received over 500,000 likes before this march got organised, sending a crucial signal to anybody thinking about joining the march that they weren't alone, that the march was viable, that it probably was going to happen, that it might make a difference. Scaling up to something really important. Now, almost every country in the world, including mine, including yours, have experienced something of this kind since 2011. Some kind of expression of political political expression of discontent, desire to change the political world, to change policy. Moving from something as dramatic as the events of Tahrir Square to something more prosaic, this is a mobilization around petitions in the UK context, petitions directly to the government, a more sort of peaceful method of expressing discontent. What's interesting here, and this is the first example I show you of big data, this is a big data that we collect of every single petition to the government over the last 4 years. That means we collect that every hour. We have a record of every single signature to every single petition. And although that's a fairly small, it's a small example of big data, if you like, because in kind of quantum physics terms, it's not huge. But it tells us something quite interesting about the participation, about societal participation in digital settings. We can look at that data, we can model that data, and we can try and understand how they take place. So one of the things it shows us is that even it's not the issue of a partition that makes such a huge difference. You've got three petitions there. The yellow ones are the very, very few petitions that get over 100,000 signatures. It shows you the shape that those take. It also shows you that almost all mobilizations completely fail. Because we only hear about the ones that are successful, we tend to think that digital mobilization is a surefire way to get a million people on the street. Not true. 99.9% of them fail completely, even to get 500 signatures. They just fade away completely, and we never hear about them. For the first time, using this kind of data, we can understand that kind of phenomenon, because, of course, in earlier times, unsuccessful protests or unsuccessful political movements, we never heard about them at all. It also shows that this kind of pattern of success is not dependent on the issue involved. You've got three petitions there all relating to saving badgers. If you want to look at any sort of political mobilisation in the UK context, you have to look for a cute animal, because that's what the UK... Actually, badgers are not very cute. They're not very cute at all, but they're good at having their photograph taken. It must be the black and white, I don't know. But anyway, there you've got three petitions aimed at stopping a nationwide cull of badgers, which was a policy at the time being planned to stop the spread of bovine tuberculosis. Three petitions there, all about the badger, one of them getting very, very few signatures, under 10 signatures, one of them getting a middling amount, around about 1,000, and one of them getting over 100,000 signatures and causing the issue to be discussed in the House of Commons in parliamentary debate. Not the issue that seems to matter. But something we observed in that data was that where petitions, in that case, do become successful, then they rise very, very quickly, suddenly. That's what the successful ones, that's what the yellow ones do in that previous graph. We see that phenomenon right across this kind of mobilisation online. So here we have some YouTube videos that have that have kind of achieved a lot of currency in the past few years. Here is the video of Neda Agha Sultan, who was killed, who became the kind of face of the Iranian protests in 2009. You see here got eventually a million views, rising very, very quickly as soon as it was uploaded, and then gradually closing off. Less seriously, more frivolously, here you have President Obama, the spoof of President Obama singing Call Me Maybe in the summer of June 2012. Don't know if you remember that, but anyway, a lot of people did because it was 40 million views that received. Again, peaking, shooting up very quickly. Obama versus Mitt Romney rap battles, a feature of the 2012 election, 100 million views, again, straight up. And lastly, and again more seriously, the protests around the death of Eric Garner in police custody under the hashtag I Can't Breathe, about which there was a lot of protest in the US, again, rising very quickly, peaking off, then another spurt when the police officers who were held responsible were not indicted. This is a pattern we see over and over again. These are all mobilizations against the perceived racist policing in the US on Twitter and Facebook. Again, I won't go into detail, but again, this pattern of sparking up quickly when there is some incident. Remember, those are the successful ones. Those are the ones that caused a lot of attention. Thousands, hundreds of thousands of others just dying away and not following that pattern. So what I'm saying here basically is that citizens come across policy issues as they go about their lives on social media, that they have this opportunity to undertake tiny acts of participation, to make tiny contributions to policy issues, thereby become involved in policy issues. That these kind of tiny acts of participation scale up very quickly to mobilizations. Most of them fail, but a few succeed, and when they succeed, they do very quickly indeed. That makes them more unpredictable. One thing interesting about these patterns, conventional political science theory would lead you to suggest that those should be S shapes. We expect things to catch on, even if it's a silly video. We expect them to catch on in an S shape, to go gradually, then to reach critical mass, to shoot up, and then to tail off again. We've analysed this every way we can. We can't find any S shapes in the successful ones. S shapes would be easier to predict. You'd see them coming, but these you don't see coming. So what I'm saying here is that this world is more difficult to understand. The societal world is more difficult to understand, arguably more difficult to govern than it used to be, because this predictability, this unpredictability, this kind of chaotic nature, this springing quickly from nowhere is difficult to understand, difficult to predict. But there is a possibility, perhaps, that it might be kind of harnessed in some way, perhaps harnessed is the wrong word, but that it might provide an opportunity, this kind of willingness to make these tiny acts of participation, to become involved in policy issues, might offer the possibility to kind of improve the way we do government. I'm going to move on now to talk about big data, because as well as making the world more confusing and more difficult to predict, you might argue that there's another way in which the kind of digitization of society and the incorporation of social media into society makes the world also easier to understand and easier to predict, or offers new possibilities for predicting it. Because every interaction that takes place on social media platforms creates some kind of digital trail, and that can be harvested to produce big data. And we're all, as Professor Hopper mentioned, we're all leaving trails of digital data wherever we go right now. Every one of you that's checking your email right now is leaving a digital trail. And we've heard so much about big data in the corporate world. I think the corporate world is already talking about the big data backlash. It's talking about small data and thin data and rich data and deep data. It's almost as if big data has sort of gone and is over. And I think although we might question the use of the term big data, or at least the usefulness of the term big data, it's important not to kind of relegate it to last year's fashion without thinking about all the possibilities for government and for public policy. Because I think in terms of creating public good or social good benefits, we're actually really only just at the beginning. Because really, we've got all sorts of new ways to understand society that just weren't there before. And certainly in the UK, and I'm very interested to hear if it's different in Hong Kong, we're only at the beginning of using that kind of data, or at least that data insofar as it's new, for policy making, for using it to make government better, using it to understand society and even predict what society's doing, or predict aspects of the environment, like air pollution, like as was mentioned before. To do that, though, is challenging, and here I would also make a link between universities and government. I mentioned at the beginning that I am doing some of the work I'm talking about with a physicist and a computer scientist, two political scientists, a computer scientist and a physicist. That's a very unusual combination. It's a difficult combination too. The physicist, in fact, was the first person I hired when I became director of the Oxford Internet Institute. I used to work at the London School of Economics. That's where I started my research career. I couldn't do the kind of research I do at the London School of Economics because I couldn't give a job to a physicist. He'd be sad, bored, and lonely. And the same for the computer scientist. It wouldn't be possible. And I think there's a read across for government too, because if we want to make use of big data for government, it requires new sorts of skills, new sorts of analysis skills, skills which aren't necessarily present in government at the moment, and just as they aren't present in social science departments. Because this kind of data makes a great difference to the way we understand society. It makes a great difference to the social sciences. I'm a social scientist. Where do we get data from? Traditionally, social scientists have got data from surveys. Surveys about what people think they did, what people think they might do. Now, as we found out in, we found it out before actually, but as we rediscovered in the general election that we've just had, where the opinion polls were quite catastrophically, disastrously wrong, a survey is not always the best place to find out what people think they're going to do. It's not even the best place actually to find out what people did, as any political scientist who tries to recreate the result of an election with an opinion poll knows, because people don't remember what they voted, they think they voted but they didn't really, or they want to have voted for the one that won, so they change in their mind the party that they vote for, or they think that what they voted for was a bit of a kind of nasty option or a nasty party, so they pretend that they voted for something else. Very difficult to work out retrospectively with a survey. And the exciting thing about big data is this is different. It's real-time, transactional data about what people really did, not what they think they did. That's exciting, but it also raises challenges for analysis. After all, surveys do come with handy demographics. We know everything when we do a survey. We know everything about the people in the survey. We know who they were, how much money they earn, how old they are, etc. With big data, we quite likely know nothing about those things. And that can be very challenging. It also, as we discussed before, raises new ethical dilemmas. It raises issues of anonymization and de-anonymization, issues of privacy. It raises new issues for the very business of policymaking itself. With big data, we might have the possibility of, for example, identifying pupils in the education system who statistically are almost certain to drop out. What do we do with that information? What do we do? Do we put more resources into that pupil or less resources? Do we try and work against that almost certainty that they're going to drop out, or do we go with it and arrange some other form of education? In every policy sector, there are ethical dilemmas like that that will arise once policymakers use big data. So big data really requires a new sort of ethical thinking. Now, the universities of Oxford and Cambridge don't, well, traditionally they don't collaborate. Actually, there's all sorts of collaborations going on between the universities of Oxford and Cambridge, but we tend to pretend that we don't really talk to each other. One of the ways that we really are talking to each other is in the new Alan Turing Institute for Data Science, which is a new joint venture between five universities, Oxford, Cambridge, UCL, Warwick, and Edinburgh, and one of the research councils in the UK. The Alan Turing Institute for Data Science is intended to government to put over £40 million into this institute. We in the Oxford Internet Institute are one of the departments very much involved in that, as is Professor Hopper's computer laboratory. A key theme of that research, what I believe part of the foundational research, will be thinking about the ethics of big data, the ethics of both how to do research with this data, of using this big data for whatever purpose, but also, in fact, for doing policy with big data, because there are new ethical dilemmas that arise. I'll just give you a few, I don't know why this is jumping, sorry. So I'll give you a few examples of this. As I said, a lot of big data comes from the fact that just whenever you're on any sort of website or digital device, you're getting some sort of information. You're generating some sort of information about the fact you're there. So you can plot linguistic patterns in Twitter networks. For example, this is done by my colleague Scott Hale, is the Twitter networks after the Japanese tsunami, showing how different makeups of languages communicated with each other and acted, bilingual people acting as nodes between language communities. This is data derived from the parliamentary record in the UK, one of the sort of oldest sources of data, but it's never been data before. It's just been a load of really big books of the entire record of called Hansard, of all parliamentary debates. But now that data is available in digital form, and my colleague Jonathan Bright has analysed 75 years of it to show that, to analyse the rate that the speakers in the House of Commons are interrupted over those 75 years, to show how government has become more contentious over time, something that everybody says, but we've never had the data to prove it. Here's the use of Wikipedia data to predict an election, and my colleagues are involved in a long-running project to do this. Hopefully, eventually, be able to take over from the opinion poll, the flawed opinion polls. This is predicting the Iranian election with Wikipedia, which Taha Yassari claims to have done. He did actually assure me that he put it on Facebook before the election. I mean, in general, we're very good at predicting elections after the event, but it is perhaps more useful to do them before, and this was done before, but not very much before. But Wikipedia data has shown itself to be very useful in this context. This is a model, just to illustrate the example of how sometimes you do need the kind of models. The kind of data that I'm talking about is the data that is much more familiar to the physical and life sciences, hence working with physicists, because they have the right skills for using kind of huge sources of data, which the social sciences lack. And possibly government also. He modelled this data to show the rate at which it decays, showing that those sharp peaks that I showed in all of those graphs happen very, very quickly. In the case of the petitions, within 10 hours. If a petition hasn't got over 3,000 signatures in 10 hours, then it's just digital dust. Here's the more Wikipedia data showing conflict on Wikipedia mapped over the world. Something of note there, perhaps, is that the largest red circle there relates to Syria as the most controversial article on Wikipedia, perhaps the sort of signal of what was to come shortly afterwards. Big data revealing these kind of signals about what's going to happen in the world. And finally, this graph shows, something a little bit, an important thing for both. This is the use of big data to show something important to both government and to academia, perhaps. This is data from the whole the data set of the entire .uk domain from 96 to 2010, illustrating back in 96 how the yellow bit is the .co or the private sector part of that domain. The .org is the third sector or the social enterprise sector. And the green bit is the .ac, i.e. the university sector, and then the mustard bit, the government there. So you can see in the early days of the web, particularly universities, because we were kind of leaders using the web, but also government, you know, reasonably significant chunk of the .uk domain. And then you look over to 2010 and we're hardly there. We're an inconspicuously small part of the World Wide Web. Now, that's important for government, and it relates to something else I want to say in the next section, and that is government is used to the idea that it's the go-to place for information, that government's somehow nodal to society's information networks. Because 20 or 30 years ago, if you wanted to know something, I don't know, how to get the rubbish cleared or something about air pollution or something about school or what school your child should go to or whatever, then you would have asked government. And government is formed in part with the idea that that's the role that government plays in society. Now, of course, there are many, many other places that people can go to find something out. So this kind of nodality, this centrality that government used to possess, just isn't quite there anymore. Here's a Google search of UK defence policy on Iraq, something that before the internet you wouldn't have been able to dream of being able to find out anywhere. This would have been the obvious place to find it out. There's the top 10 search results, beyond which most people don't look. And government's only coming here, that's the .gov.uk website. The others are media articles. Something from the UK Parliament. But the definitive statement of what defence policy is only coming there. So finding policy information, government no longer has a monopoly on that. What's UK defence policy in Afghanistan? Sorry, no results, fine, done on my mobile phone. Government's not where you're going to find that out. Interestingly, actually, if you do find it on the government website, on a computer, it is actually 1.5 years out of date and factually wrong. So this is an important issue for government in the digital world, and an important issue for the way we do government. So I think that's what I want to talk about now. I mean, you know, what does government look like in this world? One of these articles here, and there's also a book and another article, was what was circulated as possible reading. But now I go back to the point I made at the beginning, that it was only really with the internet and kind of mass peer-to-peer communication, the domestication of technology in society, that we got so much possibility for real transformation of the state-societal relationship. And I think it would be fair to say, first of all, I think we can say that in most countries we have not seen that transformation yet, although it's been predicted for many, many years. But I think it would be fair to say that from the 2000s onwards, in many countries, some kind of use of digital technology to make government better has been the sort of dominant tool on the table for reforming public management. I think that that would be fair to say in most countries that people have thought about reforming government with digital tools in ways that they haven't before. We termed that trend digital era governance and pointed to three things that governments were doing with technology from the 2000s onwards to greater or lesser extent. One of them is reintegration. I think if you look at the previous decades, as explained in the article which some of you may have read, if you look at the previous decades before the 2000s, you saw a lot of kind of breaking up of government into agencies, into public-private partnerships, into contracts. You saw a lot of fragmentation of government. That was certainly the trend in the UK and the US and other countries. Not sure if so much in Hong Kong we could talk about that. But I think what digital technology has been used for from the 2000s onwards is a kind of reintegration of government, a kind of joining up of disparate parts of government. That's certainly what's happening in the UK in the Government Digital Service, which some of you may have heard of, a big unit at the centre of government, which has really kind of simplified some of the processes of government. For example, the UK Treasury, always when departments were asking to spend money on digital technology, the Treasury would have to approve 23 different departments' requests, deal with 23 departments when they were talking about any kind of digital technology. That's one thing the Government Digital Service has done. It's basically taken over that task from those 23 departments, and the Treasury is dealing with one unit of government when it comes to large-scale buying of digital services. That's an important change that, in my view, does make government better. Holism, the idea of focusing government around people, that's something that becomes much easier in the digital era, the idea of one-stop processes, redesigning whole processes of government around people, something that data makes much easier to do. The idea of co-production, of actually involving people who are showing themselves willing to get involved in policy issues, to take part in political processes, of actually involving them in the business of government. That's something which becomes easier. And then, of course, digitalisation, the idea of automating things, but also disintermediation of removing people from the process, the idea of government processes not involving any people. That is a relatively new idea. It's not something we could have done 20 years ago, but now it is possible for government, for example, to, I know this isn't the nicest, sort of most benign form of government, but it's easy. Most governments do have a way of delivering somebody with a speeding fine or a parking fine without any human being making a judgment on that. It's done completely automatically delivered automatically, and it's only the exceptions that are dealt with in any non-automated way. In this sense, the digital part of government has gradually, over time, becoming the most important part of government. That's what I would argue. All these processes are taking digital technologies to the centre of government and making that the most important bit. Actually, I think that process has been going on for many decades. Somebody said that to me when I was researching information technology and government in the US back in the 1990s. Somebody in the Internal Revenue Service said to me, eventually the we will become our information systems. But that was a kind of very narrow world of a kind of computer person in the midst of a bureaucracy that wasn't interested in computers at the time. But I think now we really are seeing that. We really are seeing digital technologies at the centre of government. In the article that some of you might have read, we argued that you can divide kind of recent efforts towards digital era governance in sort of two waves, and that what we've seen since 2005 is something a bit more radical. Yes, we've seen co-production, we've seen some government agencies in some places start to incorporate the idea of using citizen feedback, of using information about what citizens are doing, and building it into the process of government. We've seen transparency of budgets and policy making used to draw citizens into a kind of citizen audit. We've seen that going on, and we've seen some moves to a kind of co-creation where government actually, where citizens actually become part of the process of designing government. The idea of the open, is there an open data initiative here? Yeah. This is the Open Data Initiative in the UK, and one of the objectives of that is actually that somehow citizens should do innovative things with open data, which will actually be used to make government better. That's the theory. I think you might say that there's quite a lot of cultural barriers in most governments to seeing that come to fruition, and it's important to mention those because it's only by recognising things that you can tackle them. First of all, is that bureaucracy is what governments do. That's what they're good at. That's what governments are famous for. So all these things kind of run rather against the idea of bureaucracy and hierarchy, and that's a threatening thing to a lot of people in government. Maybe not you guys, because you're in probably senior positions and you're here on programs like this, but to a lot of people that's threatening, and it's still threatening. The other barrier is that government's supposed to be boring. It's supposed to be formal, official, and if it's at all kind of interesting or innovative, then is it really government? There is that feeling still there within government. Maybe less so in Hong Kong, I don't know, but it will be unusual if that's not there at all. The idea that young people are not real people. In one of those reports that I showed you at the beginning that we did for the National Audit Office, we did some experiments. We did some experiments where people kind of, we tested how useful it was for people to use the government portal rather than just using Google. And some of about half our subject pool were students, not all of them, but about half of them were students. The Cabinet Office of the time actually had us remove those people from the experimental data because they said that they weren't, that they weren't really real people because they were students. I mean, you could argue, actually, that young people are more real than older people because, after all, in the future, those young people will be the only people and the rest of us won't actually be around. So this is a rather dangerous kind of barrier, in a way, to have this perception. But, of course, a lot of the things I've been talking about are most true of young people, so it is a real barrier to digitalisation. This idea of no part authenticated information, again, I don't want to generalise about Hong Kong, as I said, I haven't been here before, but in the UK government certainly, it's very difficult for government officials to guess something or to estimate something. They like it to be official. It's the world of official statistics, and estimates are not part of the governmental process. That works against some of the things that I'm talking about when I talk about digital era governance. It works against the idea of big data. Big data is all about trends and patterns. It's not about accuracy or precision. I mean, in fact, I was giving a presentation a little bit like this one to Ministry of Defence in the UK a couple of months ago. And there was a workshop the next day, so there were lots of people there from the armed forces. And a young, relatively young logistics person was talking about the idea of big data and said, that's a very difficult concept for us, because when we enter the army, he was in the army, we are given a definition of information, It's called TAPS, T-A-P-S, timely, accurate, precise, secure. None of those things are true of big data. So, I mean, they're almost being educated against using big data right across the armed forces. So in the Ministry of Defence in the UK, you have a basic contradiction that you've got huge kind of interest in big data and what it can do for the process of defence, and at the same time this inbuilt cultural resistance. And I think there's read across there for the whole of government. The idea of security, that all information is requiring the same degree of security, that's another barrier. We tend to think that all data has to be secure, whereas as the open data movement has showed, some information can just be released and then the sky doesn't fall in, nothing bad happens. The idea of kind of the boundary between state and society becoming blurred, as it inevitably does when state and society are using the same kind of technologies, if they are, again, that is another threatening idea for government. And the idea of people having a voice in government goes against many of the principles of bureaucracy, many of the original principles of government organisation. Governments basically tend to be bad at capitalising on trends within society and what citizens do for this reason. So I want to end just by going through some sort of principles which might help, some sort of governing principles in the digital era which might overcome some of these barriers. And that's how I'll finish. So here I am talking about really this idea of digital technologies being at the core of government, the idea of essentially digital government. And going back to the idea that I mentioned that really governments by this time, I mean, if you think of what bit of the Hong Kong government anyone's going to see, it's going to be the digital bit. That's the people, that's the bit that most people are going to interact with. There isn't another sort of bit that people, another element of government that people are going to be most familiar with. The digital bit is going to, in the future, be the bit that people are familiar with, that they recognise, that they expect to work well. So, moving on to the principles, any principle of government in this world has to be a principle of digital government. It has to be a digital principle. So here's one principle, and I've divided these into kind of principles, things I think that government should do, and then choice principles, kind of choices that I think governments should make. Do it once. This is one of the things that digital technologies allow governments to do. What's very popular in the British government at the moment and the US government, coming from the arguments of the writer Tim O'Reilly, is the idea of government as a platform. Is that a familiar expression here? Government as a platform? I mean, the classic example given in the UK is Lego, but I don't know how popular Lego is here. Lego? People are nodding about Lego. This is the idea, basically, that government becomes like Lego, where lots of interchangeable bits can be easily applied, even by very young people, onto a basic platform. So the standards and the characteristics of Lego that make it possible to build things with it become true of government. And In this way, the platform and indeed government itself becomes a sort of partly finished product. It means kind of moving away from the idea of government as something complete. It becomes more like a principle or an application store. This is Tim O'Reilly's favourite example, or a kind of software stack. That's the term that the government digital service use. So the basic principles for producing software, meaning that you can replicate it over and again with each new innovation that can easily be applied right across the government. The second principle is the principle of using data, and in that principle I would include using big data. As I mentioned before, states tend to lag behind other sectors in the use of big data. In the UK, we have an overwhelming tendency to just associate big data with the intelligence and security services. Huge amounts of data, we now know, are collected by the security intelligence services to counter security threats and to tackle wrongdoing and criminal activity. We're much less good at using that kind of data for social purposes, for social welfare purposes. I use the expression using haystacks to find needles because that's a bit what it's like, and then throwing the hay away, because that's a bit what it's like in the UK context, and it will be interesting to know about here. But in the UK context, policymakers are very anxious to declare we don't use that data in government. We just use it for intelligence and security purposes. Then we throw it away, or it's too big to use. We can't manipulate it anyway. They talk about all the ways that they don't use it. And there I would argue that it would actually be better if they did use it. And there are examples of states that use kind of that kind of social data derived from social media and welfare communications to actually do socially good things. Singapore is one example of that, with a risk assessment and horizon scanning system. It's not just social media data, of course, it's data from internal operations as well. And I think there is an argument for rethinking the way that we use, rethinking what internal operations data means. In the UK government, we're very bad at using just simple analytics data from government's digital presence. I was talking to a group of 50 civil servants a couple of weeks ago, and I asked there how many people had access to analytics data. And these were people who were interested enough in these issues to come to sign up for the class that I was running. Only about two people said that they had access to analytics data. Yet analytics data, like Google Analytics or whatever analytics data you have from government's own digital systems, is after all the new administrative data, and can be used to find out all sorts of interesting things. It enables this kind of model to be available to government, where there's some kind of intelligence centre where all the data is collected, where it is used to understand the operations of government, and then given in a useful way to devolved operations. This is the basic organisational principle of most retail corporations, for example, like Walmart and Sainsbury's and whatever supermarkets tend to use that kind of model. It's actually the mirror image of most governments. Most governments have data at the local level and don't have an intelligence centre. Again, Hong Kong may be maybe different, but I'm sure there are some ways in which it's not like that. So going back to the big data point, it's a question of developing the capacity, the data science capacity, if you like, to use big data. Principle three is the question of using experiments. Big data is great, but it doesn't allow you to make causal inference. It goes back partly to that question of not having any demographics of the people the big data relates to. But anyway, data, large-scale data, is just not good for being able to say what causes what. In the UK has actually been very innovative in this respect through the Behavioural Insights team, initially in Number 10 Downing Street and now spun off as a separate company, which is actually exporting the use of experiments in government administration right across the world. I don't know if they've got here yet. Any examples of a behavioural insights team here? very interesting what they're doing. The idea of it is based, in fact, they're sometimes called the nudge unit. The idea of the behavioral insights team is really based on the book by Thaler and Sunstein called Nudge, the idea that you can, that by making changes to people's information environment, by changing what Thaler and Sunstein call their sort of choice architecture, you can persuade people to make different choices, like to stop smoking or to stop polluting, or to the heat maps that you were showing would be one example of that. If they were made public, that would be a way of shaming people into not having all the, heat in their house escaping all the escaping through their roofs. That's the theory of it. That's being used to exciting extents by the behavioural insights team. But it's very interesting how physical those experiments are and how non-digital they are. There is enormous scope to kind of introduce more digital experiments based on, for example, some kind of change to a website or some change to a digital service in terms of nudging people to behave in a different way, which really are unexploited as far as I can see across the world. So, building trials like that into the process of government, I think, again, it's part of the idea of moving away from the idea of government as being finished and introducing some kind of build and learn, see what works approach, is a very exciting idea. This is more of a choice principle, more of a normative principle, and this means it means a quite fundamental change to the idea of bureaucracy. It's a funny thing when we sort of thought that technology was supposed to make us more rational and organised, but technology is actually a lot more messy than bureaucracy. If you think of this idea of dealing with people, reaching out or using data from social media, that's a very messy process. People are using all sorts of social media platforms. They're moving from one platform to another. They're even jumping from one platform to another to avoid perhaps being dealt with by government, for example, moving onto platforms which don't record or store the data or pass it over to the intelligence agency. It's a very messy world, and it makes, in some ways, it makes organisations more complex, more difficult to understand. This really confronts the sort of idea of bureaucracy, which is a process-driven, all the processes are the same, we always deal with people in the same way, which is at the heart of the idea of barbarian bureaucracy, or any bureaucracy now. And I think we have to move away from that if we're going to capitalise on the possible benefits of digital technologies for government. That means saying we want the outcome to be the same. So, for example, if we have a policy change, say a tax policy change, we want the outcome to be the same. We want everybody to know about it the same. But how we tell them about it may be completely different according to who they are, what social media platform they're on, where they are. And we have to get used to that idea. It's no good thinking we can treat everybody exactly the same. That's going to introduce all sorts of wasteful processes into the digital world. I mentioned the idea of visibility or nodality before, and I mentioned the idea that government faces new competition for visibility and nodality in the digital world. And I think the easiest way to think about this is to think about Flight 93 on the tragic events of 9/11 in 2001. Anybody read the commission report of 9/11? No? It's worth a read, but of course there's a lot of it. But anyway, in that is tragically described the progress of the Flight 93 from New Jersey to San Francisco, which was taken over by hijackers as part of those events. And in the course of what must have been a terrifying journey, the passengers who'd been told by the hijackers that the plane was going to be kind of safely landed and that they were going to negotiate a ransom, basically that they were just hostages on their way to safety or potential safety. Some of the passengers used kind of their own mobile phones or phones in the back of the seats of the plane to communicate with friends and family who had been watching the news on the news networks such as CNN, and knew by now, and knew from that information, because their friends and relatives had told them that the Twin Towers had been crashed into, they'd told them some of the other events, and they realised that they were part of it, that they weren't on their way to some safe, that they were almost certainly on their way to some sort of destruction. So they had informed themselves using digital technologies to what was going on. They knew what situation they were in. They organised an attempt, tragically unsuccessful, but by seems there is evidence to suggest that it might have worked to seize the plane from the hijackers. At every point in that journey, journey to destruction, the people on the plane were better informed than the federal agencies. There was no way that they could get in touch with the federal agencies. There was no number. The airline staff had no number to ring the Federal Aviation Authority or anything like that. The federal agencies were unable to communicate with the plane once the transponder was turned off. At all levels, the details are in the report, the federal agencies were less informed than the people on the plane. We don't know if they had been able to intervene, if they had been able to provide more information to the passengers who organised the attempt to save the plane. Would things have been different? We don't know. But the point I'm making is that if the state kind of loses the ability, it loses nodality to that extent, it kind of cedes what it means to be a state or to be a government. And I think we have a tendency to think that in a crisis, digital connections don't matter, that it's people and chains of command that are what are important. That's what will save us. And actually, in a crisis, it may be that digital connections are the only thing that can save us, not anything else, as in that case. And finally, just to end, I've mentioned the idea of active citizens. That's where I started. And really traditional models of government bureaucracy leave no room for active citizens. That's how they're designed. They're not supposed to play a role. And everything I've been talking about here is about the possibility of citizens actually managing their own affairs using internet-based platforms, thereby doing some of government's work for it. And I think we still are not at the point where that can quite happen. We're very used to the idea that with our banks, for example, that people with their banks do all sorts of things that banks used to do. And there may be a good read across for government there in being able to do all sorts of things that government used to do themselves if they can have the same sort of information provision from their banks as they get from government. If we get to that point, we might see some of the levels of co-production and co-creation that I was talking about earlier. Open data is supposed to lead to co-creation, but there's not much evidence yet that it actually does. The overwhelming majority of open data are actually used to enhance private value and for commercial gain. If an open data set, this is true of the analysis we've done in the UK, maybe different in other countries, but I suspect that there are similarities. If a data set has financial relevance, then it's 1,000 times more likely to be downloaded than one that has no financial relevance. By far the most popular data set, open data set in the UK, is the data set of unclaimed inheritances. And you can see the obvious interest in that, but it's not necessarily going to make government any better. So I think if government becomes better at that, on sort of tapping into the knowledge and understanding and willingness to participate of citizens, then that is a more kind of that's a more socially socially valuable way into the digital future, rather than kind of unleashing this kind of activity through the introduction of unpopular policies or failing services. And I'll stop there. Thank you.
Professor, this big data analysis for government policy formulation is very forward-looking, very visionary. In Hong Kong, we have a group of people, what we call the silent majority. Not sure whether it's true in UK. Many of the people don't talk on Facebook. People who talk on Facebook tend to be those who are more hostile. They don't like the government. They want to air their discontent against the government. So we are in the state that maybe not everyone is used to voice out their opinion in the social media. And so we are in the state of what you call the messiness. There's a lot of different platforms. We have WhatsApp, WeChat, and a lot of different media. And so our difficulty is how to analyze all these data effectively, and how about the silent majority, the older people? They don't used to speak out in this sort of channels. What's your experience in the UK?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And please don't think I was saying here, well, this is what we've got all sorted in the UK, so everybody do that. I mean, I'm sort of trying to point to the future and what I think, you know, there's possibilities for, rather than saying it's been perfectly done. I mean, we did a feasibility study for one government department in the UK where we tried to put some of these things into practice. We experienced exactly those kind of problems, and there's more, because I mean, some platforms, the data's just not available. Facebook, for example, it's very difficult to get data from Facebook, and it's increasingly difficult. It's changing all the time. It's not just ethically difficult, it's legally impossible. So you're absolutely right. On the other hand, there's other sources of data which can be important indicators, which are quite easy to get hold of. So I think it's a case of having a kind of general strategy or policy for doing it, rather than trying to narrow. It's a kind of principle. That's in a way why I said principles, rather than narrowing it down to one platform. So anyway, we were looking at what one department that's introducing a big policy change. It's been published, so I can talk. It was the Department of Work and Pensions. There's a big benefit changes to the benefit system going into the UK, and we wanted to see to what extent the department could use social media and the internet more generally to find out what people thought about it. So, yes, we did look at Twitter, but you couldn't possibly only look at... You couldn't come to much conclusion from that. But on the other hand, if you look at something like the Google search API, where do people search for information and what do they get when they search? That's information that it's reasonably easy to get hold of with the right technological tools. One of the things we found out there was that for a whole month, the place that people were most likely to get information from was a private sector website, not controlled by the government, with information that was factually wrong and all sorts of advertising for things which would have meant people paying for something that they should have had for free. So you can still find some things out, even if you can't find all things out. Wikipedia is another example. It's very easy to get hold of Wikipedia data. You know, viewing, I don't mean editing, which is only a tiny percentage of users, but viewing data. Yet you hardly ever hear of it being used. I think, you know, surges in views of Wikipedia are evidence of some kind of concern or interest, which is worth investigating. So that's something that governments might sort of monitor on an ongoing basis. It's got to be a general strategy, a question of sort of thinking about all those things, about thinking where people are and dealing with them differently. There's no getting around that. I mean, I hope one of the things that the Alan Turing Institute will do when it's not kind of revitalizing the British economy and creating hundreds of thousands of more jobs will be doing that kind of thing, working out ways that you can use this kind of data for real insight across platforms. And sometimes that will link to the other things I was talking about, like experiments. I mean, by government actually reaching out onto those platforms and getting visibility on those platforms itself. I mean, we could have spent the whole session talking about that. There's a lot to say. So, I'll stop there.
Professor Margetts, thanks for your presentations. One of the example that you quote is about UK Ministry of Defence. They have an idea of TAPS. To a certain extent, I understand their concerns. Let me quote an example. I once read an analysis through the use of Flickr social media. API, use the API of the Flickr social media. A researcher extract data from the social media. They use the timestamp, they use the location tags, the geotag of the photos to determine the travel patterns of tourists in Europe. To a certain extent, the analysis result from the back data is quite incomplete because not every camera has a GPS. And Flickr is more popular in North America and Europe than in Asia. So the results exclude a lot of travelers from Asia. So are there any studies in UK or in Cambridge or Oxford to find out the reliabilities of making use of big data? It's strong in revealing patterns and finding correlations, but are there any studies on that?
There's starting to be. I mean, up till now, what there have been more than anything is huge volumes of studies just using Twitter data, which quite often, where it involves, you know, quite often is just Twitter with where it's geolocated, which is not random in any sense at all. It's people who have got the geolocation, are willing to have the geolocation public or scrapable. So you're totally right, and we're going to be suffering that for a while. We're going to be suffering huge numbers of studies which actually don't tell us very much at all. I mean, I think the first thing is that any study of that kind, and perhaps particularly when it's kind of a map, I mean, maps are lovely, we all love them, and I'm always asking my research, you know, can we have a map? But as soon as you've got a map of data, I mean, I showed a couple, and I could have showed you loads. As soon as you've got a map, you realize that it actually introduces more questions than it answers, precisely for that reason, because there's usually some kind of distortion in the data which has shown up. And in the end, I mean, this is going to sound like a kind of protected, a sort of turf-based sort of answer to your question. In the end, we've got to think what question we're trying to answer with the data. That's the only way we'll get an answer. And that means having social scientists involved. It means having psychologists involved who kind of understand human behavior. It can't just be, we desperately need the physicists and the computer scientists, but it can't just be them. It has to be people who know how to interrogate data with questions that will actually generate meaningful answers. And it's a vital thing to remember. It goes back to the point I was trying to make about multidisciplinarity. It cuts both ways. It needs the modes of inquiry for understanding human behavior to use this data in a meaningful way. I mean, it's something that I really believe in as far as the Alan Turing Institute is concerned, because, you know, it does become possible for people to do things that is completely meaningless. I mean, there's some very, very clever engineers in the UK who are producing this thing called the mood of the nation based on Twitter data. So it has a face and it runs through all the Twitter data in the country over time, and the face changes, you know, it becomes happy and sad and shocked and angry and all those things. It's really, really clever in engineering terms. It's also, in my view, really, really pointless. It's completely pointless, you know. But if you actually asked something, people's kind of, if you ask questions geared at understanding people's perception of well-being, as you might have asked previously in a survey, and when I said that about survey, we shouldn't throw all surveys out of the window. You know, years and years of trial and error and understanding have gone into understanding what questions we should ask people in order to work out, say, the state of the nation. And we need to apply that kind of understanding to this kind of data. And there are ways of doing it. But it can't be done without that kind of understanding of people and human beings. Otherwise, we will do lots of really, really clever but not any point in them things.
I would like to ask two questions. Okay. Just now, Professor, you have mentioned the isocratic government, and then there's the active citizens, and then the isocratic government. Can you share with us about the effectiveness? Say, for example, how many active citizens have contributed to the e-petitions, and how many policy agenda items that you have established going to the e-petitions? This is the first question. And the second question is, just now, the presentation slides, you have mentioned that those young people may not be real people. Okay, how can you authenticate those contributors when they contribute to the e-petitions so as to ensure that they're the real people?
Sure. I don't remember the exact figures, but petitioning has become very popular as a mode of political participation. The petition data I showed you just came from the platform that goes directly to the UK government, which is one platform. There's all sorts of other platforms, you know, international NGOs run their own petition platforms, and then you have platforms like change.org, and I'm sure they're equivalent of these in Hong Kong, for example. It's very popular. I couldn't tell you the exact figures, but I'd say at least between a quarter and a fifth of the UK population have been signing petitions in the last 3 or 4 years. And it's definitely sort of challenging voting as the most popular act of participation, at least at the subnational level. Between a quarter and a fifth, I'm saying that, but that actually relates to data from 2000. It's higher than that. It's difficult to tell because, you know, when you think of all the data, it comes back to the messiness point. There's all these different petition platforms, and you get to the point where if you want to ask people, and you can't link all the data together, you could get some very interesting answers if you could, but you can't. So the only way to find out is to have a survey, and then that would probably be very inaccurate because people don't recognise what they're doing as petitioning anymore. But it's a good chunk of the population. It's definitely a popular activity. In the UK, we've seen real policy change as the result of petitions, starting with the first one, which was under the previous the Labour administration prior to 2010. That was the first one to go over 1 million signatures. It got 1.8 million signatures on road pricing. And the government, and they have declared kind of semi-publicly that was influential in causing them to reverse the policy. The last Conservative Liberal coalition had several policies where they did a U-turn, which again, hard to get them to say that, but I mean, must clearly were at least fueled by petitions on privatizing forests, for example, health service reforms, even the badger. The badger, you know, they reversed the policy on the badger cull, and that has to have something to do with public opposition to the policy of this kind. So we have seen real policy. Are they real people? Well, there's a system of authentication for signing a petition, so you have to, you have to receive an email and then authenticate. You can only do it once with the same address. It's true that there are people who put in multiple petitions. We have analysed that data using the names of the people who started the petition and shown that there are some people who start up a petition every day. I'm not quite sure why, but I mean, you know, that doesn't seem to me particularly democratic if one person's signing, setting up a petition every day and it's going nowhere. But I mean, you know, the point is that it in a way, it's a nice example of data making it possible to redesign policy, the very petitions platform itself, because by looking at the data, you can see those kind of things, and then you can change the platform to make sure that those things aren't happening. So, for example, the new government, when the petition platform goes up, because it was closed down for the election, are going to have a threshold. You have to have, I think it's 6 signatures or 10 signatures before a petition, you know, actually becomes available to the public, to stop people just starting them like that. And there's all sorts of other things you can do with thresholds and deadlines and things like that, which make it more sure that they're real people and that only real people are making a difference. Once you've got the platform, I mean, it's a nice example of government as a partly finished product, because once you've got the platform, you can look at the data and then feed that into the design of the platform to make it better and to make it more sure it's real people.
Thank you very much, Professor, for the very eye-opening talk. I'd like to ask, I'd like to describe what you've talked about as two parts. One is about, implication to government actions in terms of two areas. One is to make informed decision through using all kinds of data analytics out there, which this first part, I think, for government to adopt and adapt is slightly easier. It requires change of mindset, the knowledge, the right people, but then the change of mindset will be essential. And after that, probably the acquisition would come. The other part, which is always a myth to me, in the sense that that is the part about reaching out for the government. For the government to reach out to engage the public via the internet or social media, for example. I've listened to talks, and the most urgent question I want to ask is there any sort of classic case of success that we can refer to what the government has done in the e-platform in terms of, say, social media engagement that is highly successful? Previously, some people quoted, for example, the first Obama election campaign, and that was when Obama was competing for presidency,
yeah,
rather than when we become the government proper, because there's a huge difference between campaigning and giving out information as the government proper. You know, that was on the internet, you know, you just talked about digital dust and, you know, the need to have your basically attracting so many likes right at the instance that you publish the information. But that essentially is almost like against the idea of government proper, where we're the serious one, cautious, legally liable for what to say, the kind of information we can release. So, I mean, is it a lost battle for even before the game is starting, or can we look up for some successful case to say to model after what we do?
That's a totally good point. And this whole question of kind of government resisting social media is totally true. Even the government digital service, and the government digital service, you know, is quite famous. People are coming from all over the world. And in the US now, they've tried to, because again, you're absolutely right, Obama was brilliant at using this kind of thing when campaigning, and really disappointing using it when he was governing. And indeed, the US are now introducing some kind of mini government digital service themselves. I mean, they're like copying the UK. That's not a good sign. and even the government digital service, I have to say, are a bit resistant to the whole social media thing. I mean, you know, so innovative in some ways, but when it comes to actually kind of using Facebook or Twitter or these other things, kind of much more reluctant to do it. But I would say it's definitely going to happen, and in some cases it's become increasingly ridiculous that it doesn't. And perhaps the best example, I mean, perhaps we have to look at other sorts of organisation rather than government to see the examples. So if you think of take TripAdvisor. Do you use TripAdvisor here? What? Now, we don't know why TripAdvisor works. Why do people contribute to TripAdvisor? Anybody here, do people here actually put reviews on, or do you just read it? You put reviews on. You do. Okay, so that's three. But everybody uses it. I use it. I don't put reviews on. And God, I'm a professor of the internet, you know. I mean, we still don't really understand why people do that. What's the motivation? What's the incentivization? Why are they being so altruistic? Is it, are you different sorts of personality from, you know, you three? You different sorts of personality, you different sorts of people. Why is it? Well, I mean, we could talk about that. But I mean, the question, we do have to build our understanding of those kind of models, because we know they work, and therefore they ought to be able to work for government. And there are examples. I mean, in the UK for the last few years now, there have been various rating sites of health services. The first one was called patientopinion.org, and there's another called iwantgreatcare.org. And they're where people kind of rate their health services that they've received. And when those were first introduced, everyone said, oh God, you know, people will just be posting everything negative, it will just be loads of criticism of government. But it wasn't actually, it was about half and half, you know, it was actually valuable information. But they've never managed to get the kind of population of those things kind of up to enough coverage. They never got enough people using them to make it successful in the way that TripAdvisor is successful. But the main reason for that is because they've always been done by these sort of social enterprise organisations, and government itself has not really engaged. There was this attempt called NHS Choices, which was supposed to be going to do that, but you know, the rating system, it was too, you know, they were too scared. The rating system was kind of six clicks into the system. You know, they never really used it. And I absolutely think that governments have to and will confront this, and where they have. I mean, perhaps the best answer to your question is, for example, say, using Twitter for complaints, for certain sorts of complaints. Now, complaining about government services in the UK is something that's done really disastrously. It's not standardised across any organisation. Every agency has a different way of counting what's a complaint and for dealing with it. Nobody collects proper data on complaints. It's a total mess, always has been. But Twitter does provide a way of picking up on certain complaints. And some organisations, not quite government, but you know, the rail companies, for example, in the UK, and the Eurotunnel, so they're private, but I mean they could be public, they used to be, are using it quite successfully in that way. So somebody can, if you complain about a train in the UK, you can try it. It's more complicated, I suppose, if you haven't actually taken the train. And you'll get an immediate response, some kind of dealing with it. And there's a lot of scope to take that further. And I think government agencies are very scared of doing that, but I think it could be done. But you get other approaches, and a good example of this is bus companies in Oxford. So one of my research team actually made a complaint about it wasn't even really a complaint, just an observation that this bus had been cancelled and there was no information or something and it had been delayed for hours and hours on Twitter, and received a sort of direct message from the bus company saying, please don't go public, you know, if you've got something to say, say it to us privately. And it's like, come on, you know, they're using Twitter as an information services, and every bus in Oxford, you know, there's a notice and say, you know, check for travel updates on Twitter. So they're using it instead of, you know, their website and stuff like that. But they're not using it to actually engage and make use of kind of feedback from citizens. So there's a lot of scope. So there are examples of it being used successfully, but I mean, you know, I think there's massive possibilities to extend it. And we should be able to get some kind of TripAdvisor for government services. I mean, it's a social, technically, it's perfectly easy. It's just a question of using those kind of social processes, but I'm sure it's possible.
So, Professor Margetts, from the perspective of a political scientist, I'd like to know your views about the grand spying plan on citizens exposed by Edward Snowden. Because on one hand, it seems to be justified on the account of national security, but on the other hand, it seems grossly unethical to intrude into privacy of the citizens without their permission. So how to strike the balance from government or citizens' perspective?
Yeah, well, as I obliquely referred to when I was talking, I don't have the same perspective as everyone else, and Professor Hopper, for example, may have a different perspective, because one of my feelings is that about that is we've always known that the security and intelligence agencies in the UK can access data, any sorts of data about us, telephone data. You know, the intelligence services traditionally, and people knew this, have collected huge quantities of non-digital data on whether people were wearing jeans at demonstrations back in the 1960s or whatever. You know, all sorts of data has been collected by the intelligence agencies, and we knew that. And what was extraordinary about this was kind of the quantities, and that nobody kind of knew. I mean, that's what was dramatic about the Snowden revelations, that these huge quantities of data were being collected, and that people didn't really know that they were being collected in that form. I mean, lots of people did know, but, you know, the general public didn't know. But many of my issues with it are actually not ethical exactly, but, you know, number one, are they really dealing with so many security threats with this data? I mean, maybe yes, but that's what we don't know. We still don't know. We don't know actually how useful it is being. It seems to me that kind of collecting data so massive that you self-proclaimedly can't analyze it, collecting data that's too big to use, it doesn't sound to me like a very efficient way of tackling security threats. I could be wrong, but the point is I don't know. And I, more than anyone, would be one to try and find out or make it my business to know. We don't know how much it costs to do that. I mean, I've been looking at government computer systems for a long time, and everything I know about them, certainly in the UK context, is that they don't work out as planned, that they go massively over budget, that they involve some huge contract which has spiralled out of control. Yet here we're expected to believe that this is all fine and it's being done, you know, to time and to budget. And from what I've heard of the kind of motivations for doing it, and again, you know, I could be wrong, but if you read the such documents that have been leaked, it's all about mastering the internet, being in control of the internet, keeping up with the US in the case of the UK, GCHQ. When you try and master technology or kind of control it, something always goes wrong, because it's not quite like that, in my view. So it kind of worries me for those reasons, and also the one I mentioned before when I was talking, that if all that data is being collected and it's all just being thrown away without trying to do anything socially useful for it, with it, to find out things about public health or kind of you know, social problems or unrest or unhappiness or concern or whatever, then that seems to me the most terrible waste. I mean, why is it not being used for those things as well? And I know only one country where that is being done, and that's Singapore, where they actually are trying to use the data that was collected for the same ostensible reasons. They're actually trying to use it to tackle social problems like housing. I'm actually going to Singapore in a couple of weeks' time, and I hope to find out more about it. But of course, you know, it's not the perfect example. Singapore's not a democratic state, and it may be being used for all sorts of terrible things. So it's a question of transparency, really. I mean, the ethical question, which was at the heart of, the ethical issues, which are the heart of your question. If we know so little about it, it's very difficult to say whether it's ethical or not. It couldn't be properly ethical without being more transparent what's being done. And I don't really see the security threat to making it more transparent. But you might disagree. Anyway, we're supposed to be having joint questions now, aren't we?
Yes, so could Professor Harper please join? And perhaps now we can have a relaxed conversation about...
I'm relaxed.
So, a question for both of you. So, are we ready for big data? Technically and socially, are we ready for big data?
Is that for me?
For both of you.
Well, there are technical challenges, but most of the technical challenges have probably been overcome at some point in the scientific world, or by a corporation, or by a weather organization, or whatever. I'd say it was understanding the kind of social insights that can be revealed by big data that we're kind of behind on, if you like. Kind of some of the things that we've been talking about, the meaning of big data, I'd say that's where we're behind, that it lags, that the social understanding of big data lags behind the technological issues. And this kind of bifurcation between those people who understand those things, the social things, and those people who understand the data. They need to work together. And that's not always easy. It's not easy in the university world, and it's not easy in the government world either, to get those people together, working together, talking to each other.
Well, I'd like to just amplify a couple of points I made. From an engineering technology point of view, most of the things that I've been involved with, these big things in the past, were an unexpected pleasant surprise. Big data is the opposite. Everybody thinks it's the most important thing since sliced bread, and they're trying to be socially good, business good, whatever, whatever, whatever. And that's the new one on me, right? Internet of Things is another such thing. Everybody says we're going to make money out of Internet of Things, whereas in the past, when the, you know, say the smartphone or the feature phone or whatever came along, ooh, that's nice. Ahead of that, they weren't already planning how to do X, Y, and Z with it. So I see this as fundamentally different from a sort of enterprise innovation and what about it point of view. Hence some of my comments. I think we're likely to be disappointed in the short term, as ever. as a point in the short term, although I believe it very much in the longer term, and hence my comments about the younger generation and just pay attention to them rather than old fogies like me. There are an awful lot of barriers that have to be resolved, as far as I can tell, to make possible some of the more optimistic views of the use of big data in some sense.
Thank you. Thank you both professors for very excellent talk to us. My question is that can we look at the issue from a wider perspective? Is big data the topic? Is it a subject a zero-sum game, or there's a win-win-win situation, meaning that everybody can get more, or any loser from the move towards big data? Socially, scientific-wise, or even business-wise?
Well, yes, there are some. As I said at the beginning, internet penetration is rapidly rising. We might expect in some contexts that we will reach some kind of universal kind of penetration of the internet, for example. But at the same time, I don't think, I do quite a bit of work with an economist, and he always argues when people talk about people who don't have access to the internet, he always says we just have to wait for them to die. I don't think that actually is going to work. there is a real danger of marginalization, that some people become completely marginalized, and it's a kind of spiraling, it'll be a small section of the populations, but it's still crucially important to issues of social justice, because channels, at a certain point it will become non-viable to produce kind of various channels for them, and then we run the risk that they disappear, not just from, say, services or something like that, but also from the data. And at that point, you have a really serious problem. So I think you have to fight marginalization with this kind of data. And you do have this sort of conflict in a way that big data is most important when N equals all, when it represents some kind of whole population. But so often it doesn't represent N equals all, so very often. And that's where, the disappointments come. Having said that, I would disagree with you a little bit. If you think of the success of Uber or Amazon or, right through the short history of the internet, we've basically seen internet-based platforms which are based on big data. But that's what they are. They're a web-based platform and a lot of data. So, I think we have seen quite exciting things come from it, which we might expect to be applied to the, to the governmental world as well.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure we disagree. If you take Uber, in the red corner, you've got the established taxi businesses, which say, "Oh my God, this is the end of the world. Our, disruption," and they're right. On the other hand, you've got some very simple data to do with location, as it happens, which was provided out of a non-market Ministry of Defense, U.S. DARPA. Funding, provide a universal service on which businesses were built, and provides a particular kind of data which is available, and people seem to be yet again sharing it absolutely, completely, and loving it, and almost disregarding anything else because the facility is better. So I do believe in that sort of style of of data. I'm not sure, maybe as ever it's a discussion what big data is. It's the sharing of much more than that for me that I wonder which will happen. So I'm kind of, I don't know, I'm torn. On one hand, I like to be an optimist, but on the other hand, let me try and explain it in a slightly different way. We designed the first indoor location system in 1988, and we put it in, and we had it, and we knew where everybody was in a building. And I was on panels in 1990, 1991, 1992, where I could have been shot, right? I could have been shot. How could you do this? You're just the evil incarnated. It's terrible. You're going to end the world. Why are you doing this location? It's all terrible, terrible. And I say, well, we just couldn't find each other in the building, so we said we'd do a little bit of technology and so on. 25 years later, you know, in any dimension, it's all super successful and so on. So now I think today, what's the comparison with big data? Because that was just a little simple, you know, not much data, although the data turns out was interesting. So it was some kind of data. What's the equivalent today where, yet again, sharing human genome, my genome, for public purpose from which you can work out various things. Sharing my information or other stuff. It seems to me the feedback of the crowdsourcing negative is very strong, even stronger than I felt it in the academic context before. So maybe I'm a little pessimistic on this. I hope I'm wrong. The pushback can be quite substantial. So maybe I'm getting this wrong.
Thank you. It's for Professor Margaret. About the analysis of the big data from the social media, say a government policy, they tend to give likes and dislike. So, but there are, in this world, it's not just white and black. It's all different shades of grays in the middle. And maybe the beauty and the best solution lies in the gray color. But it's almost impossible to go through each and every millions of opinions to find out what they really mean by that statement if you don't just look at the like and dislike. How do you tackle that problem? And to find out the real tendency, whether it's just a simple white color or it's just close to the white color, but it's actually a bit of gray. And yeah, that's my question in mind.
It's another really good point. I mean, and in the early days of the internet, from a sort of political science perspective, people got terribly excited about the idea of sort of deliberation on the internet, that we were all going to have these sort of carefully crafted public views on what to do based on discussion on the internet, like some Athens assembly, you know, from ancient Greece. And I think that's absolutely not what the internet's good for. And actually, we've still got a long way to go with sentiment analysis before we really will get the kind of shades of grey, if you see what I mean. And it's better at counting things. It's much better at counting things. You know, it's better at kind of, some graph over time which shows peaks which might be warning us about something, or shows things that rise quickly, or S-shapes, or all those things, which really are likes or dislikes, or mentions versus not mentions, or downloads versus not downloads. I think it is better for those things than the grey in the middle. So in that way, it's more like a, you know, translating it for government services, it might be more like a sort of, I don't know, a tin opener, or I mean, it reveals something, something that we should be worried about, that we then have to investigate further, like a failing hospital or a failing school or something like that. It's crude numbers. It is. I think that's where the insights are going to come from. rather than necessarily some kind of ability to analyze actual opinions. I mean, having said that, there's other instances. I mean, if you take the TripAdvisor, the TripAdvisor example, I mean, on TripAdvisor, people give their opinions, and then that's useful to the people who are going to use that thing. I mean, that hotel or that journey or whatever. And there, I suppose you have got the possibility of using data. But I mean, that's not really... I don't know that you're exactly using that in a big data sort of way. I mean, there is a read across there, I think, for the individual. I mean, if your child has been told that they're going to go to a certain school, then there would be a value in there being lots of comments about that school that you might go and read as an individual. But in terms of making qualitative, using the data to make sort of qualitative judgments, that might well work. And that comes back to the ethics of using data in the policy context. It may really not be ethical to do that, because it does always provide an incomplete picture. And there is the danger of, giving sort of low rankings to surgeons or doctors who work in deprived areas and therefore have a different likelihood of having a good success rate and this kind of thing. So, yeah, it's part of the ethics of using big data for policy making that becomes particularly difficult when you're looking at those kind of qualitative judgments. There's a lot of advantages to just counting.
I got one sharing and one question. The first sharing is probably related to what Winnie has just mentioned. Currently, I think in this part of the world, we don't use Twitter a lot, unlike Singapore. Twitter, correct me if I'm wrong. I mean, in Hong Kong, we use a lot of WhatsApp, which is kind of bilingual, meaning use of English and Chinese and actually Cantonese. That poses a lot of challenges for metadata analysis. For Twitters, I'm sure that some of my colleagues will know that some of the software easily available on internet, you can do this big data analysis. So, most of the government department in Hong Kong I stand correct if I'm wrong, don't have Twitter account or don't have Facebook account. So what traditionally we do is, we rely on feedback from newspaper, mass media, and then we respond to these queries, challenges, or questions in the traditional way, that is providing feedbacks to questions posed by mass media. I'm sure that until and unless that metadata analytic technology we solve, that is how to analyze data from social media comprising English and Chinese. Otherwise, it will be really a challenge for government departments to monitor each and every fits, whatever. And that's my sharing. The question is, Professor Marcus, earlier you mentioned about the use of Wikipedia, and I'm sure my colleagues share some views. Wikipedia, government department look at the Wikipedia, especially when article posts there relate to reputation, organization reputation. For those who know how the Wikipedia works, actually there's a conflict of interest clause, meaning that, say for example, if there are articles posted there related to your organization, you can't actually edit it if you are part of the organization. So that poses a lot of challenges. That clause of that conflict of interest also include employee, past and present, or directly and indirectly related to the organization. So I'm not sure whether in UK, how organization, how government department tackle that issue, reputation threat, posts on Wikipedia, by bias article. You can easily put post article with citation, bias citation. That's my question.
Well, the question of multiple languages is very interesting. I did show at one point an image of a Twitter network, which was done by somebody who works with me called Scott Hale, and he and a lot of other people are working on this issue of multiple languages. I mean, those were Japanese and English. He speaks Japanese. Well, he's actually married to somebody who's Japanese, but you don't have to go to those kind of levels to do this kind of analysis. I mean, that there are a lot of people working on that, and I can put them in touch with you. It sounds like Hong Kong would be a very interesting example of kind of multilingual activity on social networks. I think we've started to know something about it in terms of the people who kind of act as bridges between kind of monolanguage communities, you know, bilingual people who are bridges between different communities. There's some really interesting work on that, and I can make sure that you get access to it. The question of Wikipedia, yeah, I mean that is a good point. You mean that it's difficult for government departments to. Yeah, I think that the thing there is that Wikipedia is something that was built outside government, and used outside government, and government's coming late to the party, and it's all been invented without, you know, it's all been developed without government in mind. So that's a nice example where actually government is having to kind of reach out into social media. For fear of losing visibility and losing nodality, and government departments do have to do that, and it's difficult for them that they've got to work out ways of doing it. Yeah, but the sooner they do it, the better. That was a key thing actually that we did observe when we did this work with the Department of Work and Pensions. You know that the people were going to Wikipedia, and at one point the Wikipedia page was just either not there or out of date or whatever. Got to find a way of doing it, and this is part of the challenge for government of engaging with applications that just have got nothing to do with government. But you know, the world's not going back. The world's got used to finding information, finding knowledge, finding out about things, either from organisations that have got nothing to do with government or from each other. And that means that government's got to go to those places. I mean, if you think about kind of experience of services and experiences of welfare services in particular, you know, there's a big forum in the UK called Mumsnet, which has become tremendously popular by people who care for children, basically. And if government wanted to be in a debate, wanted to be part of or to know about any kind of debate about how services are playing out or aspects of the school system, it would have to go there. You know, there's no alternative. The world's not going to go back. So it's part of the process of governing now, I think. I can't remember who was asking the question. I think perhaps it was in your session. Somebody was asking the question about a kind of success. Well, a couple of people have mentioned, you know, where are the success stories? I was just interested to know how much. I was in Rio de Janeiro a couple of months ago, which is being much touted as the example of the kind of the smart city. Any news of that reached here? Anybody? I mean, I just thought you might be interested in looking at what they're doing there. It is it's difficult to tell, you know, how transformative have actually been, but it's definitely an example where they're using all kinds of social media together. They're bringing it all together. I should have shown a picture of it, actually, where they, you know, it's this massive sort of centro they offer up there, and it's, you know, covered in screens all around all the people who work there are wearing white suits like in NASA, modelled on NASA. It's a rather extraordinary place, but it is an interesting example where they are pooling all kinds of social media data. They're using data from kind of applications that are used for traffic congestion and for things like that. They're sharing data with those applications, sharing data about people and opening up the data so that they can model traffic congestion. The whole thing was set up in reaction to the disastrous floods of 2010, where lots of the cities sort of slid down the mountains. They've got a whole meteorological center there. They're modeling meteorological data like it's never been modeled before. They're putting all this data together. They have a certain news agency there so they can interact with the traditional media as well, so they can play that data back on traditional media to any people who don't have internet access. It's worth, you know, if you want a success story, or at least something which purports to be a success story, it's merging all sorts of different social media sources and playing it back to the citizens, and has managed to do it without being massively unpopular. They managed to separate themselves from the security and intelligence bits, which is done at kind of state level rather than at the city level. So they've managed to be the kind of clean guys. As far as I can see, they're not kind of unpopular or mistrusted, but are actually seen to be doing something good in terms of managing the city and managing crowds in the city and traffic in the city and generally making life better. I may be romanticising. I wasn't there very long, but it's worth having a look at.
So I'm afraid we've run out of time, but perhaps we can continue to come to you over lunch.
Sure.
And also, you know, I knew that we're going to have the pleasure of your participating in the afternoon, so you're invited to participate in the discussions in the afternoon as well. So, thank you very much.